Hey everybody, it's Lon Seidman, and we're taking a look today at the new Yoga 910 from Lenovo, and this is a two-in-one, kind of a premium version, because this is starting around $1,200 or so. You might be able to find it less on some retailers. And what this is an i7-powered device with a really nice hinge mechanism on here that gives you a lot of flexibility as to how you have the laptop oriented. So right now, of course, it's in laptop mode. You can flip it down into display mode here. So if you want to display front and center, it is a touch screen, of course. Or you can have it go into tent mode like this and give you some additional options as well. So it follows that yoga product line that we've seen before from Lenovo, but this is the latest version. Now, I do want to mention, in the interest of full disclosure, this came in on loan from Lenovo. So when we're done with this, we send it back to them. Nobody is paying for this review. All the opinions you're about to hear are my own, and no one is reviewing this content before it is posted. So let's get into the hardware here and see what makes this tick. So it's got that Kaby Lake processor, an i7-7500U, 8 gigabytes of DDR4 RAM. It's set up in dual channel configuration, so you get slightly better performance as a result of that. 256 gigabyte SSD. It's a 14-inch display. It's actually 13.9 to be exact. 1080p IPS touch display. It weighs about 3 pounds or 1.38 kilograms, so not too heavy, and folds up to be a pretty small package here that you can very easily walk around with. It does get a little unwieldy when you have it in the tablet mode, of course, because you are holding essentially a 3 pound tablet. So I'm very used, of course, to holding much lighter tablets, but if you want a very large 14-inch tablet here, you've got it. The bezel here is pretty large because what they did is they moved the webcam from up here to down here. So it does make it a little weird when you're talking to folks, very similar to what we've seen on the Dell XPS 13 and 15. They also have a very similar bezel that you're kind of having the camera look up at you, which looks a little odd. But you can, of course, as a fallback measure here, go into tent mode to start your conversation. And because you have a touch screen, it may not be all that hard to get that conversation going. So I found it better to be web conferencing in tent mode versus the regular laptop mode on that. The keyboard and trackpad aren't bad. My biggest gripe with Lenovo lately has been the fact that they keep putting the shift key over here. So I'm always hitting the arrow key when I mean to hit shift. And again, this is something that not everyone thinks is a problem, but I do. The keyboard is backlit. A decent trackpad here. It feels very high quality, as I would expect it to feel on a laptop at this price point. On the side here, you've got two USB Type-C ports. Now, it's important to note that this one here is power only. So you charge and power the device with this port. This one does video and USB data, but no power. So if you're looking at one of those all-in-one single cable docks that charge and do all the other stuff, this one will not do the charging port. You have to do the charging portion through the charging port and not through this USB Type-C port, but it does do data and video, but no Thunderbolt. So if you're looking for a Thunderbolt device, this is not the one for you. On the other side, you got a full-size USB port, a headphone microphone jack there, and a power button, and that is all there is to it. A pretty basic machine here, at least insofar as its overall utility, but it does work pretty well. So let's take a look now and see how it performs. All right, so I'm going to unlock it with my fingerprint here. There is a fingerprint reader on the front of the device. It seems to work pretty well. Every once in a while, I do have to have it scan my finger again, but generally it lets me in. And what we're going to do now is go over to my 1080p 60 video example on YouTube to see how it performs. You can see just how effectively this i7 processor works at bringing things up for you. It supports wireless AC, so if you have a newer router, it will give you the best possible speeds off of that. So I was quite pleased with the speed we're getting out of there. And I'm seeing decent performance on 1080p 60 video. One of the things to note here with laptops and Chrome is that they typically don't optimize Chrome for these Intel processors. So you will occasionally get a few drop frames. Nothing noticeable so much on this chip because it's so fast, but Edge is actually the better browser for YouTube watching, believe it or not, on most of these laptops. And I've done a video on that if you want to learn more. But the i7 here does compensate for some of those inefficiencies, and it does seem to be playing back quite smoothly on here. Web browsing is also a pleasant experience. It comes up very quickly, just like the YouTube page did. You can find your new home away from our solar system, if you wish, on NASA's website, and you can see how quickly everything renders in and starts to go. The trackpad's very nice. Of course, you can use your finger to browse around as well if you want to put it into tablet mode or even in this mode. The display is really crisp and clear, nice nice viewing angles on it. The color is very well balanced on these displays. Lenovo, even on their lower end laptops, usually has a very nice panel. This one is no exception with IPS and all the good stuff that comes with it. So a real pleasure to read on this panel. The speakers are okay on it. They are kind of underneath it. I don't really see any speaker grills, so it's not the best sound, but it's loud enough to conduct web conferences and that kind of thing. If you want to do music or something like that, I might suggest plugging in some headphones just to get a better audio experience. But the speakers are stereo and certainly capable for whatever you wish to do on your laptop audio-wise. Now, I also run a benchmark in Google Chrome called the Octane Test, and this gives us a number to see how well it performs against other computers that run that same test, doing what I think most people will do with this computer, which is productivity, web browsing, work, email, that kind of thing. And on that test, we got a score of 35,610, which puts it actually above last year's Yoga 900, which you would expect, which came in at 31,259. So this new i7 is slightly faster than the i7s on prior generation computers, at least for this kind of thing, and it's not too bad there. And the battery life is actually a little better on this chip versus last year, so you're going to see better battery life as a result. And I think if you're limiting yourself to mostly web browsing, some maybe Google Docs or some email and some word processing and other applications, you'll probably get close to the 10-hour mark that they're claiming on the device here. So decent battery life out of it, and all in a really nice productivity machine. Let's take a look now, speaking of productivity, at Microsoft Word. All right, so here we are in Microsoft Word. We've got our newsletter template loaded up here, which has a bunch of text and graphics in here, and you can see just how quickly it renders and responds to changes in the document. So I think any kind of desktop publishing, word processing, spreadsheet, office work, even Photoshop and some video editing should also do pretty nicely on here, just given how nice this display is and how responsive the processor is. This thing is really built for this activity. This is not a gaming machine, but it is a very good productivity machine, which is what they are gearing it as. But we will take a look, though, at some games. So let's start with Minecraft, and then I'll talk more about what it can and can't do when it comes to entertaining yourself. All right, so here we are in Minecraft, and what's funny is I'm hitting 60 frames per second here almost exactly, even though I turned off all the frame limiters, but that is what we're getting out of this. What I am noticing from time to time is that it jumps down to 30 frames per second because it is throttling based on processor load. So this will throttle back, and you'll see a reduction in performance from time to time. I'm going to talk about that a little more when we get to our benchmark discussion. Now, what they do is they put the air intake and exhaust into the hinge mechanism in here, which is a good spot to put it because that way you can put the laptop on your lap and not have it block an air intake, which would overheat the laptop. The problem is that it does have a very tiny fan that has to spin very fast, so it's very noisy as a result. So even sometimes when it's sitting in the background and it might be running some background maintenance task, you will hear that fan kick on, and sometimes it gets pretty loud, especially when you're playing a game like this. But you will get decent performance out of casual games. Probably see better performance out of the Windows 10 version of Minecraft as well. This is the Java version that most people still run. Let's take a look at one more game, and then we'll look at those benchmarks. All right, so here we are in Rocket League. I've turned down all the settings to get us the best possible performance we can at 1080p. And one of the things that I've noticed here with these Kaby Lake processors is that they do handle 3D gaming a little better than their predecessors did, just not to the point where I could say it is GPU quality. So we are getting about 55 to 60 frames per second here with all the settings turned down, with the game looking pretty ugly. But it is very playable at 1080p. It just won't look as nice as it would if you had a discrete GPU on your laptop, but they are getting there. And on the 3D Mark CloudGate test, we got a score of 5,472, which puts it about the same as last year's model. So it was interesting. We saw better performance in the things that this laptop is designed to do, but a little less performance when it comes to gaming. And that's why I never really recommend these computers as gaming devices, just because their small form factor makes it very difficult to get rid of the heat that gaming creates within its processor and its casing. So we saw on the Lenovo IdeaPad 510S, which we looked at about a week ago, its Intel graphics actually run faster with the same processor because it can get rid of that heat a little more efficiently. So there are things that they engineer these machines to do, and this one just isn't engineered as a gaming device. So if you are looking to play games on this, probably not the best laptop for you. I would look for something with a discrete GPU, but you will have to get something slightly bigger to do that. Now, one thing this new laptop does better than the old one is playing back some of the super high-end video formats, namely the HEVC USB-C codec that many of you write in about when I do these laptop reviews. This new laptop with the Intel Kaby Lake processor can process this file here. This is 140 megabits per second. It's at 4K resolution. We're downsampling it to this 1080p display, and it has a 10-bit color. So it really is pushing the limits here of what laptops typically can do. And most of the time when you play this file back, you will have zero drop frames, perfect frame rate on this one. This is a 30 frames per second file that we're playing back, and it looks great, as you can see. Now, there is a 4K version of this laptop available also for more money, so you really can take advantage of some of these newer formats and play those video files back smoothly with really no issues whatsoever. And again, that's something that is new to the Kaby Lake line of processors. I do believe Netflix, if you want to play back 4K on their web client, will require one of these chips. So this is one of those things that you gain from getting the latest technology. It doesn't always give you a huge boost in overall performance, but there are areas in which it does better. It also does very well with Blu-ray movies. There is no optical disc on here, of course, but I did extract some movies from discs, and I played them back on my computers here, and no issues here whatsoever. Really smooth playback, and really a good experience. You can, of course, hook this up to a TV with that USB Type-C port and get a 4K output going from it, even if you only have the 1080p version. It does look a little weird, though, having this big bezel down here that kind of moves the image up in the middle, especially for some of these wider screen movies. But overall, the display looks great, and the playback performance, as you saw, is excellent. So overall, this is a good laptop. If you are looking for something like this in the mid to high range 2-in-1, this is certainly going to do it for you. You get all the performance that you would expect from an i7 with this size of machine. Really nice display, some weirdness with the webcam placement, but I think that did result in a laptop that's a lot smaller to carry around, which is probably one of the trade-offs that they made with it. And I'm quite pleased with it. Again, it's not going to be a gaming machine, but it does do a lot of other things very well. And again, I think it's pretty decent for the market space that it is in. This is Lon Seidman. Thanks for watching.
This channel is brought to you by my Patreon supporters. If you want to help the channel, you can by contributing as little as a dollar a month. Head over to Lon.TV/Patreon to learn more. And don't forget to subscribe. Visit Lon.TV/S.